There is a new report tonight alleging that Donald Trump had an extramarital affair with a Playboy model. First Lady Melania Trump drove to Air Force One separately from the president today, walking to the White House, South Lawn, and Marine One by himself ahead of his trip to Parkland, Florida. The New Yorker's report describes an affair between President Trump and a Playboy model and, more importantly, the National Enquirer's alleged role in keeping it secret. Brian Stelter is out front.
Donald Trump and former Playboy model Karen McDougal. In a bombshell story, The New Yorker is detailing evidence of a nine-month affair that started in 2006 and a payoff scheme to keep the story from going public before the election.
Karen McDougal feels that she ultimately was, in a sense, cornered into a set of contracts that she finds onerous and exploitative. She's frustrated, I think, with her inability to speak, in her view, and she has regrets about this.
Ronan Farrow, writing that the National Enquirer paid $150,000 for the exclusive rights to McDougal's story in 2016, but then never published it. The company in charge of the tabloid, which is unabashedly pro-Trump, says it did not find McDougal's story credible. But former employees of American Media, Inc., which owns the Enquirer, says this is a classic catch and kill. You buy a story unfavorable to Trump, and then you kill it, you bury it.
What it really means is it takes the story out of the market so it won't see light of day.
Why? Well, American Media's chairman, David Pecker, is a longtime personal friend of Trump's.
These guys met many years ago and have maintained a friendship for a long time. And David Pecker takes care of his friends.
It's a back-scratching relationship, with Trump sometimes praising the Enquirer.
I've always said, why didn't the National Enquirer get the Pulitzer Prize for Edwards and O.J. Simpson and all of these things?
During the presidential campaign, he even mentioned it while implying that the father of Senator Ted Cruz was involved in the assassination of President Kennedy.
On the cover of the National Enquirer, there was a picture of him and crazy Lee Harvey Oswald having breakfast.
That was debunked. More recently, MSNBC's Joe Scarborough and Mika Brzezinski claimed that the White House threatened to run a hit piece on them through the Enquirer.
They said, if you call the president up and you apologize for your coverage, then he will pick up the phone and basically spike this story.
On Twitter, Trump called those allegations fake news. More fake news is also how the White House describes the alleged affair between Trump and Karen McDougal, just like it is denied the alleged affair between Trump and porn star Stormy Daniels. Trump's personal attorney, Michael Cohen, admits he paid $130,000 for Daniels' silence ahead of the 2016 election. And which tabloid has been all over that story? No, not the Enquirer, but its rival, In Touch magazine.
There you go, some media competition. Now, Jim, the National Enquirer's parent company says the idea that it could influence the president by holding back or disseminating damaging information, they say it's nonsense. But the evidence is pretty overwhelming. And my question for them, which they've not answered, is how many other stories have they done this with? How many other stories have they caught and then killed to protect President Trump?
Part of a pattern. Brian Stelter, thanks very much. Out front now, CNN senior political analyst Mark Preston. Mark, you now have two stories here, fairly well documented. You have the Karen McDougal story. I spoke to Ronan Farrow earlier today. You have the story, Stormy Daniels story, evidence of a pattern, it seems.
Apparently, President Trump has some deep-pocketed friends who are willing to pull money out of their own pockets, to try to protect him. Now, we saw that with Michael Cohen, who said that he used his own money, did not expect to get reimbursed by President Trump. And, of course, as we've just heard from Brian Stelter right there, that we have this media executive doing the same exact thing.
Yeah. Did you take any notice of the White House response to this story, adding the phrase, the president says it didn't happen, whereas in the past, often there's been a straight-up denial, but here, quoting the president as denying it. Do you think there's any importance to that, or any meaning to that, rather?
Well, Jim, it kind of dovetails what we heard from Sarah Huckabee Sanders when she was at the podium this past week when she was discussing the Rob Porter incident, right, situation, when she said, I'm giving you the best facts, I'm paraphrasing, that I have at the time, or that we have at the time. And that's the first time we've heard that from her, in some ways inoculating herself from having to go in front of the media and speaking to the world with inaccurate information at times or misleading information at times. And I think what we've seen in this studio, in this situation regarding, President Trump and the First Lady, was the same thing.
Final question here, just quickly. The personal issue is one thing. Voters can make their own judgment about that, right. American people. When would it become illegal for a payment like this to be made?
Well, if it was done much like we saw with the Michael Cohen situation, if it was done in the event to try to help President Trump become elected, then it could become problematic. And that's when you go back to what we saw Michael Cohen, his personal lawyer, in his statement, Jim, when he revealed that he had made that comment, he said this was a personal payment. This was not a campaign expenditure.
They all happened within days and weeks of the election. Mark Preston, thanks very much.